BRT Hermelin, who was an honorary professor in the department from the 1990s into the 2000s. She's really known for her pioneering work in the field of autism. I'm therefore delighted that Professor Francesca Maffei from the Institute of Psychiatry has come to talk about her own pioneering work in autism that really follows on from a tradition of thinking about autism in very different ways that BRT started. So first what I wanted to do is ask Professor Pamela Heaton to come up and share with us some thoughts about both BRT's life and work from the perspective of both a colleague and a good friend of BRT. So can I ask?
Rebecca, for organising what I think is a very, very important event for Goldsmiths. I feel very honoured to introduce this session, and I'm going to start a little bit by talking about the life and research of Beata Hermelin. So Beata was known to her friends and colleagues as Artie, and she was born into a very wealthy and highly educated family in Berlin in 1919. She had a very privileged childhood. And I think her early life must have been very enriching in a lot of different kinds of ways. So her family knew all of the most important artists, intellectuals and writers in Berlin at that time. And she spent a lot of time in the theatre and at the opera house and things like that. I remember her telling me once about her 7th birthday, which involved going to the opera house to see Magic Flute and then having dinner afterwards with Furtwängler, who was the conductor. So I could do some kind of gist about the way the family operated. But against this kind of very rosy kind of enriched childhood, we have to remember that this was a Nazi Germany, and the period that she was living in was particularly horrible. There was an increase in anti-Semitism, and then when Hitler was made Chancellor in 1933, a lot of this was made into law. And this really impacted on artists' life because they restricted citizenship and they restricted the rights to work and the rights to education. Artie's father was a very successful lawyer with a very large and thriving practice in Berlin. And of course, under Berlin laws, he was not allowed to practice law anymore. And her sister was not allowed to attend her school anymore, so had to go and work in a factory. So Artie's education at the beginning went quite well. She liked school and she was doing very well. But after a couple of years, the head teacher came and told her parents that they needed to remove her from the school. What happened was that the Nazi Party put pictures of Hitler in all public places. And there was one in the entrance to her school. And she was on a mission to persuade all the children in her school to refuse to salute to Hitler when they came into the school. And the headmaster thought this was very, very dangerous. There were lots of Nazis in the school, and it was dangerous for Artie, and also very dangerous for the other children at the time. So she left school. She was then educated at home by a professor of Egyptology from Berlin University, who was also Jewish and had been removed from his post as professor at the University of Berlin. So I think that was kind of, she told me quite a bit about the experience of learning the basic schooling with an Egyptologist, the very Egyptologist. And I think it gives us some kind of insight into the very quirky and interesting way that she thought about things later on in life. During this pre-war period, things got increasingly worse and worse, and not being able to work because they were poor, very poor, and things were getting more and more fraught and difficult. And she told me that the people in her family were made to feel like rats in a trap, and they just absolutely had, she had to get away. So she fled to Israel in 1939, and this was the start of a whole new period in her life. When she talked about her early life in Israel, it was extremely positive. She absolutely loved it. She enrolled in an art school and she trained as a silversmith and a goldsmith. She absolutely loved the climate, she loved the culture, she loved the food. And she talked a lot about how welcoming you know, her fellow Muslim and Christian students were to her. So even though she was very, very poor at the time, she did really thrive in that environment. And during that time, she met her husband, Rolf Hermelin, who was a German filmmaker, who was from a family that had also fled from Nazi Germany. They were quite a left-wing family, that they had family members who died fighting for them because they were very involved with human freedoms, and they were quite political and interesting people. Artie was a very frank, I would say probably a very frank and conventional person, as I'm sure that people here knew very well. And she told me that when Rolf asked her to marry him, she told him that she wasn't ever going to marry anybody, and so she had enough money in the bank to pay for a divorce. But despite this initial skepticism, she did marry Rolf, and the marriage lasted until his death in 1989. In 1948, Artie and Rolf decided that they didn't want to live in Israel anymore, and they left Israel and came to the UK. So Artie was trained as a silversmith, but of course, because of her experiences in Germany, she didn't have any education, any formal qualifications rather. So she started attending night schools, and she was lucky enough to meet Alan Clark then. So Alan and Alan Clark were very eminent psychologists who did a really groundbreaking work on child development. And they were quite taken with Artie, and they really saw her potential as a psychologist. So with their encouragement, she applied for a post at Reading University in the psychology department. And she was extremely impressed that the head of the department offered her a place, despite the fact that she had absolutely no qualifications at all. And she took this. She absolutely hated bureaucracy. I can't stress that enough. And she took this as a wonderful example of British pragmatism, that they could take her in that kind of way. And needless to say, she did very, very well as an undergraduate student, thrived and absolutely fell in love with psychology. And so she completed her degree at Reading, and then she went on to the Institute of Psychiatry to study for a PhD under the supervision of Neil O'Connor. We have a very close colleague of Neil O'Connor here today. So Neil had started working, his early, really influential work had been with Jack Tizard, and he'd done really groundbreaking studies investigating learning ability in people with intellectual impairments. So there'd been very little work looking about how people with learning difficulties responded to education. This work was, I can't stress how important it was, it really influenced government thinking on how to basically fund and facilitate the development of people with disabilities. So, as you can imagine from this, Neil was a perfect collaborator and mentor for Artie. And their journey was really absolutely extraordinary. Together they pioneered innovative and rigorous work that let them study completely new research questions. So, for example, we've known that there are people who might have extraordinary musical, mathematical, artistic ability and intellectual impairment. We've known this for 300 years at least. But it was only when Neil and Arthur began doing experimental studies that we got scientific papers on these people. So their research partnership was incredibly important. It lasted several decades, and it really set a new agenda for research in neurodevelopmental disorders. So Arthur worked with Neil at the MRC until her retirement in the 1980s. And at this point, she started working again with Linda Pring, who she had known very well as a student. I believe Linda had worked as her research assistant. Linda had taken a post at Goldsmiths, and Artie joined her as an honorary professor. So they then started writing a lot of research grants and a lot of research papers looking at special skills in autism. And the work, really, the theoretical work, the focus of that work was quite unique at that time. We were really focusing then on the cognitive and social impairments in autism, and of course that's incredibly important because it provides a scientific basis for for interventions, educational therapeutic interventions for people with autism. So it is important, but we may be to some extent got an impoverished view of the complexity of autism as a disorder. So Artie Linden's work was very, very much concerned with looking at strengths in autism. And they were also interested in looking at interactions between the pattern of impairments in autism and the kind of strengths that we see. So for example, one of their really important papers explored semantic weaknesses in autism and the perceptual strengths that we see. And they looked at these different types of abilities in people with exceptional artistic abilities and autism. So while Artie was at Goldsmiths, she was very active in postgraduate supervision, and I was lucky enough to be one of her PhD students. She was extremely dedicated, and absolutely nothing was too much trouble for her. I remember finishing a data analysis one night at 11 o'clock, and being so excited about it that I rang her up to tell her about it, without realising how late it was. And she didn't make a murmur of complaint about this. And it wasn't until I put the phone down and I realised how inappropriate it was to actually call her about this really probably very important data analysis. She didn't take many students, but when she did, her commitment to their intellectual development was absolute. She passionately believed in intellectual freedom and creativity for her students and collaborators. She actively encouraged her students to seek new areas of research and develop new ideas. And she very much taught us that it was okay to make mistakes. So at the beginning of my PhD, I was working on studies of musical savants, and I was really unhappy about the way this was going. You know, these people had extraordinary skills, but really it seemed to me that they should have been studied when they were two or three. You know, that would have been better. And I was sort of worried about what kind of data I was going to collect and how I was going to deal with it. And I was also very worried about the sort of theoretical underpinnings of savant syndrome in terms of music. The sort of idea was that musical savants have extraordinary musical abilities, and we have to compare that with people with autism that don't have any musical abilities. And actually, there was no evidence whatsoever that that was the case. None. It was just an assumption. And I was very, very keen to try and explore that kind of idea myself. And I talked it over with Artie. I remember really clearly her saying to me, you know, I think it's an extremely risky thing to do, but I thoroughly encourage you to follow your instincts. It was a really, I would say that Artie represented a real turning point in my life, and I think this was true for very many of the students who actually worked with her. I think summing up what she was like as a person, I think I would say that she was dauntingly intelligent, cultured and brave, and she cared very much about the arts, and also she cared very much about human freedoms. She was quite political in her outlook. And her intellectual contribution to research, particularly to developmental psychology, has been absolutely enormous. So it seems apt, in the light of Artie's emphasis on the talents and strengths of people with autism, that Professor Happe has titled their presentation "The Beautiful Otherness of the Autistic Mind." I know that Artie would have absolutely loved this title, and she would have greatly applauded the research approach. So it gives me great pleasure to hand over.